can everybody hear me? Could somebody in the back raise their hands to show they can hear me? Thank you. This is an emergency meeting of the Cape Elizabeth School Board. The purpose of the meeting is to advise the residents of the opening of the schools and the structural problems of the middle school building. First, all grades will attend classes tomorrow. Arrangements have been made for certain classes to meet in alternative classrooms, and these arrangements will be described in a few moments. With the exception of the middle school 7th, 8th wing, all the buildings, including the portables, have been inspected by an outside structural engineer, David Tetro, of Design Consultants, and have been found to be safe for use. Mr. Tetro is here tonight to discuss his inspection and answer questions. Mr. Tetro confirmed the opinion of the two other structural engineers, Mr. Hutchin and Mr. Koudelaitis, that the 7th, 8th grade wing did present a significant risk. The engineers, the fire chief, the building inspector, the builder, the superintendent, the business manager, and I discussed this afternoon the alternatives at length, and the superintendent will shortly describe to the board the proposed solution. This will consist of removing the new roof, repairing the old roof, which is sound, and putting the new roof on next summer after proper engineering has been designed. Tonight's meeting will consist of board discussion of the proposed solution. Then I will invite public comment for 1/2 hour on this specific issue. Speakers will be limited to 2 minutes. Then the board will vote on that issue. After that, I will invite public comment on any issue related to this general matter. As we intend to go into executive session tonight to discuss litigation surrounding this issue, and as it promises to be a long session, and most of us have been working on this problem nonstop for several days and nights, I would appreciate it if each speaker could accept a 2-minute limitation and an overall limitation of 1 hour. I am sure that all of you would like to know what happened and who is to blame. I would too. And I will in time, and so will you. But up to now, our concern has been to find out the technical nature of the problem, to get the school open, and to get our kids back to school in safe buildings. On behalf of the entire board and staff, I apologize to all of you, especially to the kids, for this bad start. I hope we can make it up. Finally, I have to tell you that it will take time to find out exactly what happened. And while we are going to find out, we are going to do it in a fair and objective way. As litigation may result from this, I and others involved may not be able to answer all of your questions at this time. Please rest assured that a full report will be made. The school board's outside independent counsel will assure that this is accomplished in the shortest possible time. There are no words to express the horror that we all feel at the thought that some winter day, the roof of the school could have come down on the heads of our children and teachers. And I want to reiterate the words of thanks we spoke last night to Mr. Hutchin, who spoke out of this situation and, when his warnings went unheeded, had the courage of his convictions to speak out a second time. My son is only one of the many who could have been under that roof. Now, I would like to ask Mr. Tetro to describe his inspection and answer questions. Mr. Tetro.
I was brought on this case just this morning to take a look at the roof that Mr. Hutchin had looked at, as well as the temporary portable structures and the wing next to the IA building, the connector link. Up to now, the only inspection that I've done has been concerned with just the dead weight of the structure itself, not including any snow loading, and I think there will be some other problems that come up when we do look at snow loading conditions. The inspection included reviewing whatever documents were available and doing a walkthrough on all the structures and doing some fairly conservative calculations to ensure that the schools could be open prior to snow season. And I concluded that it was safe to occupy the buildings at this time. There's still a lot of analysis to be done, and we'll continue with that, but I feel confident that the buildings are safe as they are, with the exception of the 7th, 8th grade wing that will be closed. And I guess I can answer any questions.
First, I'd like to ask if the board has any questions on Mr. Tetro's inspection. Any questions from the public? Seeing none, I will... Oh, I'm sorry. It's kind of dark out there. Could you come to the podium, please? Where there's a loudspeaker, microphone.
Or if I speak right up. But Mr. Tetro, give us just a very brief description of technically what the issue or problem is in that particular area of the building.
In the area that's being closed?
Yes.
There were some new wooden roof trusses that are about 60 feet long, put over an existing flat roof. And they're bearing on a very small structural steel angle. It should probably be more a fairly large size I-beam. And right now, with only the weight of the roof itself, it's standing up, but I tend to doubt it would stand up with a heavy snow load.
Dave, I'm concerned about any possible damage that has been done to the walls of the 7th and 8th grade wing by having this roof in place in a short time it has been there. Has that been looked at, or will it be looked at?
Well, yes, the whole building will be looked at very thoroughly. Are you talking about the exterior walls?
The exterior walls of the 7th and 8th grade wing.
I don't think there's any concern with the exterior walls. They're all glass curtain walls, and they haven't been affected by this at all, and they should have been.
Analysis also include the portable classrooms in the Pond Cove building?
I did a visual inspection of the portable classrooms. I didn't do any calculations on them. And there does need to be some additional roof bracing added, cross bracing between the trusses that are there. Right at this point, with just the weight of the roof itself, I have no problem with it. The trusses bear directly on individual studs.
Any other questions?
Did you take into account any wind loading on the existing roof structures other than triple the weight of any potential snow load?
Yes, I did look at wind and dead load that we have on there now. Again, that was on the connector building. That's where the calculations were done. There were no calculations done on the 7th and 8th grade wing. I think just by inspection, there's definitely a problem there.
How long would it take to remove the trusses and repair the roof and have the building been ready for occupancy?
Well, the contractor indicated it would be 3 or 4 days to remove the trusses, but I think there were some questions involved with removing the sprinkler system and getting the roof patched. But I assume it's around a week.
I have a question. There were three engineers that looked at this today, is that correct?
I'm the only engineer that looked at it today. Physically looked at the buildings.
Yeah, he was the only one.
Yeah. Mr. Tetro made the was the outside structural engineer who we retained following, I believe, with Mr. Ferguson's suggestion last night. The other engineers that I referred to were Mr. Hutchin, who made the observation on August 10th, and the third one was. And I apologize to the gentleman, I believe his name is Bill Kudelitis, is associated with Mr. Armitage, who's done a significant amount of architectural design work for the school. So those are the three engineers to whom I refer.
And were they in agreement with Mr. Tetro?
Yes, they were. Well,
Mr. Hutchin has never spoken to a school board member or any member of the school staff on this issue. His role was to make the observation on August 10th, and when his warning was not heeded, he then sent a drawing and spoke to the building inspector, Mr. Fain. That's been his own involvement, but you know, clearly his observation was confirmed by the other two engineers.
Chairman, I have some
complete information that answers the gentleman's question. If a vote is appropriate this evening, at 7 o'clock in the morning, the sprinkler system will be dismantled. And Friday at 8 o'clock a.m., a crane has been promised to the roof contractor. So if it doesn't rain or bearing any problems, we could have the school on Monday. Okay, sorry, one more question about that.
On that August 10th, when you noticed that problem, who did you give the warning to? And why did it take so long to get to you or us?
I do not have the complete story on that. It's one of the pieces of information we certainly intend to find out about. My understanding is that on August 10th, he was on the school premises in connection with another matter. He was representing an insurance company, and he noticed the structural deficiency, at least what was in his opinion a structural deficiency, and he mentioned it, I understand, to the subcontractor, and that is tonight's newspaper said that information did not reach any town officials until Friday night. Friday afternoon.
Just a quick question. Was there ever a set of plans drawn up for this project, and if there were, was it ever stamped by a registered professional engineer?
It's my understanding that the answer to both questions, well, the first question is no, obviously the second is also no.
Seems to me on a project of this magnitude, especially involving a structural
that certainly is would have been certainly what I would have thought, and certainly that's part of the investigation that we're going to undertake.
When you speak about the contractor who was going to be removing the roof, are you speaking about the same contractor who installed the roof? And so, you think that's proved safe?
Well, nobody's going to be in the building when he does it. Discussed to my knowledge, although I did leave several times to deal with other matters in connection with this case. Dr. Pelletier, you were there, was that, and Mr. Tetro, you were there also?
Yes, I think everyone around the table felt that he was the appropriate person. He knows how it went in, he knows how to take it out, and as a contractor, he's the children.
Well, this obviously is a matter for both insurance claims and a number of other claims. And as I referred to earlier, that's something that I really just can't comment on. I would expect that it would not cost the town anyway.
Okay, it's my understanding that we have a contractor here who did something that was not a very wise thing to do. And you as the board think it's okay to use this guy to repair what he obviously didn't do right in the first place.
Well, this is what
who hired this contractor, who checked his references, which is what standard procedure is if you're hiring somebody to roof your own home. Who checked all of these? Who does that? Who accepted his proposal and who checked his references?
The usual public procedures for bid were followed. Contractors.
Who does this? Who in Cablesmith does this?
The bid is put out by the school department to the contractors, and at a given hour they all are invited to come to the town hall where the bids are open. And certainly the you know, one does check the business manager, checks references. The previous record of any contractor is examined. And cost is not always the only issue. Reputation and integrity are also important issues. Sorry, what is the question? Who were the bidders? Who made the decision to choose the contractor?
Yes.
The business manager, I believe, chose the contractor based on the bids. That's the business manager's job.
Where are we at?
Where is this?
We are seeking that to justify how we felt.
Excuse me, the business manager is at the meeting, and I would like to ask him to come up and answer these questions.
Great!
The process was undertaken by past experience with a contractor. At this point, I think I've outlined my status this afternoon with the school attorney, and there are implications that at this time I really don't want to talk about. I mean, I've been this could lead to litigations that I can't talk about tonight.
Mr. LaBelle, may I ask you a question? Do you, in your good judgment, think it's a good idea to use the same contractor to try and repair what he obviously screwed up at the beginning?
What might be seen as what was screwed up in the beginning at the time was not apparent to any of us school officials.
Well, maybe not to you, but to him. That's what he does for a living. He didn't know he was screwing up or that he wasn't doing this properly.
The process was never made aware to any of us in the school department.
No, maybe not to you, but he obviously has to know what he's doing.
That's,
and if he didn't, then why are we still using him?
That's something we talked about today with the attorney. It's more complicated than it seems. I wish I could answer all your questions tonight. However, there are other parties concerned that, you know, there is an investigation going on. We've met with the attorneys. We've provided the attorneys with contracts, with specs and things of the sort. They're being reviewed, and we will be advised as to where the school department does stand on such an issue.
Why are they going to go ahead with this and use the same contractor? Why not change contractors if this other thing right?
Did the contractor build what he said he was going to build?
That's an issue. Like I said,
so you're going to have him tear down what he's already done before we get somebody else in there to find out about it?
But there's certain alternatives I think that the engineer could get into as far as what could be done to that one roof to make it safe or used in as a band-aid type thing. We at this point there's a time frame where school needs to be in session. Number one, if this would have been brought up in early August when it was made aware to certain people, I don't know if we'd be standing here tonight. I don't know, maybe we would be. I don't know. All I'm saying is that at the meeting today with the engineers, with the architect, with quite a few people around the table, it was decided that the best way to address the problem was to, the quickest way was to dismantle the roof. Then do structural designs or whatever needs to be done to the building to see what it will accommodate. I think Mr. Tetrol could speak in retrospective to this, because, you know, being an engineer, as to what things he might be looking for to redesign the building.
I want to ask a question. When this was put out for proposal, were there, in fact, a set of specifications outlining the details of what this job would involve? And if so, who prepared it?
There's no sets of specs.
Who presented a bid package to contractors and had no specifications? I wouldn't have my driveway paved without that.
Then again, I can't answer that because there's certain things led to certain things, and at this point, I just don't feel.
How could you even put something out to bid without specs? I mean, how could you realistically evaluate any bids without having any specs before? Or have them even have specs before them to bid?
I can't answer.
I guess the question that's been asked earlier, I'd like to have the answer to it, is I guess it's been asked, three different questions have been asked. First question is, who was responsible for putting together the package that was submitted to the various contractors for bid? That's one question that's been asked. Second question I'd like answered is, I understand you've had Dave here go out and do an evaluation for you to determine whether those buildings are safe, but I'd like to have a clear understanding of what Hutchinson's position is on whether or not those buildings are safe to occupy. And
well,
thirdly, one last question, if I could,
yes,
if Dave is in fact saying that those buildings are safe for occupancy, is he in a strong one to put that writing, certify that to the town of Gateway?
Well, I can answer that, yes. I don't know where all this is leading to. I was brought in as a totally independent engineer. I'm a registered professional engineer, and I'm working with complete ethics that are governed by the Board of Engineering. I'm not about to jeopardize my engineering license to keep anybody out of trouble or to try to make something go away. Al Hutchins did not look at the connector wing building. I believe that I'm the only engineer that looked at that building. Three engineers looked at the grade seven and eight building. We all agreed that there was a problem there. I think we have two separate issues we're talking about here. I feel completely confident that that building, the connector building and the temporary buildings, or portables, whatever they're called, are safe for occupancy until there's a snow load applied to them. And as I said, I haven't done a complete analysis. I've analyzed the dead load condition only, dead load and wind load, actually. And I feel confident they're stressed to like 50% of their allowable stresses. There seems to be no problem whatsoever. And I'm certainly willing to stamp a letter, you know, certifying that's what my findings are. I think there will be work done on all three of those areas before winter, though.
Now, let me just go back to what I said earlier about the, you know, what we've done so far. What we've done so far is to find out the nature of the problem, the technical nature of the problem, and make arrangements to get our schools open. The next phase of this process will be to answer all of the questions that you have all posed in various ways about drawings, building permits, the bid process, and that will be undertaken with all due speed. And we will report on that fully.
Are we to understand that this thing was put to some type of a bid? Is it a design type bid? You must have had some criteria for accepting bids on this. You didn't just tell a guy to put a roof on and let him go ahead and do it. How can that happen?
I will find that out.
And then you're going to go ahead and let the man do the roof with no instructions and no bid, and now you're going to have to take it off? Is that choke of common sense?
It's a terrible situation, and
that's like putting the fox in the chicken yard, they got the chickens. He's made the mistake, and now you're going to let him can compound it? I don't think that roof should come off. At least I have full respect for David. If he thinks they can take it off and do it right, I go along with that. But certainly someone should say that.
I'd like to ask my previous question to the inspecting engineer. Do you think it's proof for us to use the contractor to install the roof to take that roof off under circumstances?
Well, under the circumstances that the roof will be taken off when no one is in the building and the contractor is, I assume, bonded. I know nothing about this contractor. I have never worked with him before. I've never worked with the Cape Elizabeth School Department before. Normally, when there is a construction problem, the contractor who caused the problem is the one who does repair it. I haven't seen, hardly ever have I seen an additional contractor, a separate contractor coming out to fix a to repair a problem. It's the normal procedure to have the contractor take it apart and do it again. And I don't know what the contractor used for plans or specs or how he decided to put it all together or what his experience is.
We have a current certificate of insurance from this contractor to verify that he is insured and bonded. And who has inspected that current certificate of insurance?
Dee, have you inspected that certificate?
He is insured on his job, not bonded. He's insured, not bonded.
May I ask that you want to ask questions, since there's so many of you raising hands at the same time. Come down to the front and just form a line so we can move this along a little faster and hear a little better.
Does the contractor have a permit today?
Dee? Yes, I think the answer to that is. Yes, the permit for that roof, as I understand it, is part of the new portal.
When did he get the permit?
What day is the permit?
I don't know. We got copies today. I don't know if that's one of them.
So, today?
The building inspector was at a meeting this afternoon and said that permits would be arranged for the removal.
Okay, so they're going to be arranged. Is Kate Currier right that the building started without permits?
I think that may well be the case, and that is also going to be part of our investigation.
Is it against the law to do any construction without a permit?
I would have thought so.
So, did the contractor not break the law? And did the responsible parties at the school board level, whether the business manager or above, disobey the law by not issuing or following with a permit?
Well, your questions are noted. I am unable to respond on advice of counsel.
And if the contractor violated the law, shouldn't he be fired on that ground alone? Sounds like he's still in violation of the law, man.
Sam?
My concern is that if this same contractor is going to be doing the repair work, is he going to be doing the work per someone else's specifications, like Mr. Tetro or someone who knows about, say, construction?
There will be, on that point, I can assure you there will be no future construction without proper architectural and engineering drawings.
All things being equal and the fact that there is a big mess here going on, I am concerned that schools are going to open, children will go to those schools, and before the snow season starts, things will not be rectified, and children will be in those buildings when snow starts. Once the children start school, will they continue in school, or will we see breaks in education?
I do not believe that you'll see breaks in education. I've been assured by those involved that whatever minor rectifications have to be made, are indeed minor, can be done rapidly, and I would not anticipate any further problems beyond this one based on the information that we have so far, which I believe in this area is complete.
And if for some reason the middle school has to be shut down, will the elementary school be shut down for convenience sake, or will that continue? It was said in the paper this morning that the elementary school was shut down as well as the middle school due to the fact that it would be convenient.
No. That is not the reason. Questions were asked by citizens at the meeting last night about all the buildings involved in which there had been recent construction, where the portables have been put up. And to be on the safe side, which we must be, we decided to examine all the buildings that had undergone recent construction.
If there's litigation pending, is it wise to take these buildings down and to tamper with this until we know where we stand and until this comes to court, or are we destroying evidence?
There will be a photographic record.
Have
believe the town is aware that there is a department, a state department, that provides a service for any public school buildings that have construction projects done that will review all specs and make sure that they are up to the code and that they are proper. Considering the mistakes that have been made on this, I would be most, and it's free. It's free, and it's a routine procedure that's done at all public schools. I would be more comfortable that we not only have another architectural firm review that, but also the State Department to make sure it's done right.
Good idea. Okay, I think we'll move on now to the Dr. Pelletier, would you read your press release of earlier in the day, which describes the precise arrangements for tomorrow?
The entire first all classes in the Cape Elizabeth School will reopen tomorrow, Thursday, September 6th. And the teachers have met today, and arrangements have been made to provide a full program, including allied arts, for 6th, 7th, and 8th grade students. The entire 8th grade will be at the high school. They'll be bused back to the middle school for allied arts. 8th grade students are asked to bring a bag lunch for this week. Milk and juice will be available at the high school. With the exception of one 7th grade classroom, which will be located in the middle school library, the remainder of the 7th grade classroom will be located in the new portable. All of the 6th grades will be held within the middle school complex, using a foreign language room, industrial arts room, intermediate art room, and one general music room. Two of the 6th grades will stay where they are. This has been all detailed by the principals, and I want to compliment them for their swift work through the day.
Now let's go back to the precise recommendation with regard to the middle school 7th and 8th wing.
Hi, Mr. Chairman. This is the superintendent's recommendation based on the hearings we had today with the engineers. That the only way to really fix this is to remove the roof and to salvage the trusses. And at a later date in summer, do the roof in the proper manner. And I'm making that recommendation that we use the contractor to do that immediately.
Okay, board discussion now. Charlie, you had a question first.
On the placement of the students last night, one 6th grade class is going to Pond Cove. That is not going to take place.
All of the 6th grades will be held within the middle school complex.
Okay, the other question.
Charlie, want me to just tell you, the 6th grade had a choice. They're trying to do some teaming, and they felt if one classroom was over in Pond Cove, it was going to be very difficult. So they had an opportunity to use the industrial technology classroom, and that's the classroom that they're going to use. That's why we're not going over to Pond Cove.
So it'll be the classroom and not the actual industrial arts complex?
That is correct, the classroom. Yeah.
The other question is, after the removal of the roof, what type of repairs will have to be done to the roof to make it safe and leak-proof?
At the same time, the contractor is removing the group who are presently working on our roofs will patch the perimeter and any holes, and that can be done at the same time as he's removing the roof. And he's been contacted, and he's ready and waiting to do so.
If the roof is sound, then why did we put a new roof on it? There must be some reason that we were repairing that roof or replacing that roof. And why is it now a safe roof?
It's a safe roof, but it was a leaky roof. It was a 30-year-old roof, and it was a flat roof. And a pitched roof is rather
flat roof. It was deemed more economical in the long run to put in a pitch roof, which is more efficient to add more insulation. And that is, that's my understanding of it. Anybody else have any comments on that particular issue, Jane?
I don't know if this is an overreaction on my part or not, but I do have to say that I couldn't vote to have this done using the using the contractor. I think it's a bad idea.
Well, I have sat in all the meetings with the builder, and I think he's eager to correct this situation. I think he's shown himself very responsive, and I think he wants to make the maximum effort to rectify this error. And as Mr. Tetro said, I think that it's customary for the person responsible to fix what has gone wrong.
Who will inspect it if he does do this? Who will go in and inspect his work after it's done?
Mr. Tetro, you'd be willing to do that, I assume?
In the past year and a half, my firm has designed four re-roofing projects, similar truss roofs over flat roofs. One in Nobleboro, one in Aroostook, in Holton actually, and two in Westboro. And we're certainly qualified and willing to do that, and also you certainly have the right and possibly should get proposals from other engineering firms so that everybody feels comfortable with who is doing this work.
I just want to be reassured that the inspections will be totally done and we will be reassured before one child steps foot in the building.
If we were hired to do that, then that certainly would be what we would be doing for a very thorough review of it. But I'd also like to say that the general construction of that roof is actually very good. The contractor did a very good job. It's one particular detail. I don't know if he had the experience or the knowledge to even know what the problem was. And I think we're pointing a lot of fingers at a contractor. And I'm not here to defend him, but it's a pretty complicated case. And I don't think it's a clear cut point that the contractor just screwed up and that he's not competent. I don't think that's the case.
I think Mrs. Pond makes an interesting point here that perhaps we're overlooking, and that is the error was, or the truss system was designed by the subcontractor and not by the contractor in question, who would now be removing those trusses.
My question is, will any of this construction be done during school hours? Or taking down, or the crane coming in, is there anything that would be done during school hours?
The answer to that is no. That wing, we closed the wing. There isn't going to be anyone there. And we're going to rope it off. And we're going to do it Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. No, when it's roped off, they'll be able to work a section, I believe, on Friday. First cut.
We've been real careful in the past not to do any construction when the children are in school. I think machinery, workmen is just a curiosity that it would be difficult to keep children away from that kind of activity that's going on. I don't think we should be doing any kind of construction, whether it's sectioned off or not, during the time that the students are in school.
By sectioned off and roped off, I'd like a little clarification on that. It's one thing to have a 6-foot cyclone fence. It's another thing to have a rope. Well, what do we have in mind, precisely?
Well, that was one of the concerns of the building inspector, and he said that we would do it in such a way that it wouldn't jeopardize the youngsters. He said at the point when they were working, we would ask the principal to remove the people from the portable for a period of time, which which might be a day. And that is part of our discussion. Now, if things go well, and he gets started tomorrow morning, he will be off the premises by Monday. Now, if you feel that concerned, I'll work with the building inspector, and we will only have him work on weekends and after school hours, at such as if we can make very certain there aren't any students in that complex. In other words, after school, the portables would not be used if he has a day or even two in that area. So we would rope the entire area off so we'd all feel very comfortable that there'd be no danger.
Mr. Chair. I'm concerned about the traffic pad, student traffic padding for the next few days until that roof is removed. We are going to have four classes in the new portable, which is attached to the existing building. It's a question, what is the traffic padding going to be for those students to get to that building?
The way we understood it, Charlie, they would be able to travel outside and come in a new entryway right where the portable connects onto the old 7th and 8th grade wing, but it's not part of where the roofing has been done. It's part of the new construction. And we understood that the students would be able to walk. It's an alleyway between the building and the bus garage. Now, we can take another route if we have to close that off because of machinery. We can take another route. It will be longer, but we can get to the portable by coming in through the main doors, walking down through the library, out that door from that portable, and then into the rear entrance of our portable where the 7th grade classes are.
As a parent and as a school board member, I would feel much more comfortable if your ladder suggestion was utilized.
Any further school board questions on this matter? Comment?
Mr. Chairman, Mr. LaBelle referred to the question, is the contractor bonded and insured? And he said only insured. What is it? What is our legal? I'm not a legal mind, so I don't know where this puts us.
I'm not sure either. Dee, what is in this trade, what is the difference between insurance and bond?
The contractor provided us with a contract laying out basic general contractors guidelines referring to insurances, referring to certain things, even in debt as far as building permits and things of the sort. The attorney has provided a copy of that contract. It is being analyzed, and I would imagine that by tomorrow or by Friday the latest, the attorney will have some opinion as to what the contract does entail.
Now, I'm not a lawyer, but I suspect that a bond is a bond that the job will be performed and performed to the contractor, to the standard. And insurance would be for catastrophes and calamities on the job. Is there anybody in the audience? Mr. Patience. I had a feeling Mr. Patience might know the answer to that.
Oh, I was just going to say you're right, Peter. The bond is for the faithful performance of the contract in accordance with the specifications and terms of the contract. The insurance is for liability for negligence.
Mr. Counselor.
Peter, before your vote, I just wanted to add one other comment. I think we're concerned tonight, obviously, for the physical safety of our kids. I think we might be forgetting the psychological safety. This issue, unfortunately, has hit the newspapers and the television. Many of the kids are very frightened about this whole story, and I would urge that before your vote, be very clear that as little disruption goes on during the school day, for kids to be watching cranes and all of this business. I mean, I treat these people all day long for irrational fears of roofs falling in. This is a far cry.
Well,
Twitter and back.
We heard from the engineer that under normal circumstances, the contractor would do the repair work. In this case, the fact being that the subcontractor designed the structure without a permit, seems to me that we are not dealing with normal circumstances here. And again, I would ask the school board to question whether or not the contractor and the subcontractor should be arranged in the repair work. I don't think it's normal circumstances.
Well, I would suggest that the procedure to be followed would be to have the structural engineer set out the standards and the specifications for the removal of the roof, and then be on the site to ensure that that's done. Would that address your concern?
I'm not sure. Again, I think what I'm hearing from all the citizens present is the fact that we do not fall with all the circumstances. My child is an eighth grader, so he will be in high school. But certainly, if he was a sixth or seventh grader and was in the vicinity, I'd be very concerned about who's doing the work. And I also just bring it down again. Since we do not fall, we do not undertake normal procedure and have this work started. I really think we're dealing with abnormal circumstances as opposed to normal circumstances.
I don't know the whole story yet. I guess as it emerges, my impression is, not based on complete information, is that the way this roof was done was actually the way, unfortunately, a lot of projects were done. Yes. That's exactly what happened yesterday. We put out a notice that we were canceling 6, 7, and 8. And after a meeting like this, we told everybody, and that's difficult, at 11 o'clock at night, that the entire K-8 was out. Now, I've been answering that question all day. To do that again, I personally think is ridiculous. I think it's easier to make very certain that when he is working anywhere near the portables, that the principal find a way to reschedule those youngsters for that period of time and not miss any school and not upset the town any more than we have.
You ought to be very careful with the children in the school. I think you will be. I think the administrators will be. I think the teachers will be. I trust them. And I think we ought to get on with school. It's a difficult situation, and I think we ought to just be balanced in our approach to this, frankly.
Thank you. Mr. Jordan, Councilor Jordan, excuse me.
This is Farmer Jordan. I think you could take, maybe the Public Works would lend you some snow fans, and that would bar that off pretty good so they wouldn't go over it too easy underneath it if you put it up properly. It would be better than a rope, in my opinion.
I think so, too.
Number two, I want to get back to an issue, if I may. Isn't it a requirement, I know it was in the past, that to do any work, structural work on a public building, you had to have an architect or an engineer stamp on it. I tried to cut a corner a few years ago, and I was told that. I don't know if it's required now or not. And I'd like to know how many other roofs do you fix without engineering and architectural.
Thank you. Certainly my understanding that one didn't undertake any projects without proper architectural and engineering drawings, and as I said earlier, that is the next phase of our investigation into this situation, and we certainly have to get to the bottom of it.
How much money has this contract been paid by the township?
D, what is the total size of this contract?
Has he been physically paid that amount of money?
$25 to $28 million.
And are we going to pay him more money to take this roof off, or?
I don't expect so.
You don't expect so, but how can, has he said he's not going to charge us any more money to take this off?
We have not had those discussions. And had we, I would not be able to comment on them in all likelihood. But my impression is that
to move a crane in here, take off that roof, and you haven't discussed whether you're going to pay them for this stuff.
It's going to take probably a couple of days to do that, and you can figure out, let's say, with a crew of 6 to 8 men, you would be talking about a few thousand dollars.
$1,000 just for a couple of days, you think?
Yes.
I think you'll find it cost you a few thousand dollars just for a crane.
I was referring to the crew. In any event, and I take your point, it is certainly a subject for the next phase of this process. Right now, our major concern is to deal with the technical issues, get the schools open.
Is there any one individual currently at this point now in charge of seeing that the job is completed, the permits are obtained? Is there one individual now who is responsible from this point on?
No. I think that at this stage, that every member of the school board and the administration.
Excuse me, please. You're telling us you're not in charge.
The superintendent is not in charge. Mr. LaBelle has said he's not in charge. Why are you up there, and why isn't somebody else up there who will be in charge? I don't understand.
Basically nothing else since then except work on this project. That is true of a great deal of other people that are involved in this case. I don't believe that a simple answer to who is in charge is available. We're working as a team. We're trying to do the best for the community that we possibly can in a difficult situation. Answers will be found for all of these questions, all of these issues. In no way do any of us deny that there are very serious and important questions to be answered, and they will be. But right now, we've got to get our kids back
the school safe buildings.
Superintendent alluded to the fact there would be no work done on school hours or during school time, that all work would take place on non-school time. Did he not say that?
I said I would arrange for that.
Okay.
And you won't put people in quarters unless there's sprinkler system, is that correct?
Yes.
Who will provide the direction for all of this to take place? Who will there be one individual in charge to see that all of these things take place in a coordinated manner so that it's going to move up? Is there some one individual who will have that responsibility? And if not, why not?
I think the superintendent should be in charge, and I will work with an engineer who knows exactly what has to be done. And I'll work with the business manager and the contractor, and moreover, the building inspector, who is a volunteer today to make very certain that our traffic patterns and our protection is there.
So you, in fact, then will be in charge of this whole representation process and everything takes place during a period of time?
Right.
I don't. I'd like to offer a suggestion. I think my personal feelings is that the administration today has exercised an extreme of, that there's no knowledge of any technical ability in awarding or processing contracts. That's my personal feeling. I would suggest that the board tonight direct the inspecting engineer or someone to be project manager with overall ability reporting directly to the school board and not to the other administration on this particular issue.
Thank you. Councilor Reed.
Leslie, I think that we have several issues here. One is that the K-5 building is fine to operate. grade, and there's no involvement of any of those kids. That the 9-12 school can work very well and not be affected at all. I think that the classes that are affected are the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. The high school will only be affected if the 8th grade goes to the high school. I think that with the fact that we have 18 half days, we are, as taxpayers, paying teachers, staff, custodians, that it might be prudent to consider using teacher days for Thursday and Friday, allowing middle school students only to remain at home, and the time can be made up, if appropriate, in another manner. I have a 6th grader and an 8th grader. The board knows my position on safety, and I also feel very uncomfortable allowing my 6th grader to go into a building, or my 8th grade, or to go to the high school, regardless of the fact that the space has been identified. I'm also very concerned, as Mrs. Lawson brought up, that when you disconnect the sprinkler system for the 7th, 8th wing, you are disconnecting it for the 4 classrooms that are in the portable, and I have a problem with that, as well as equipment that is on site, not only for the school children that are in school, but for children who may, because they see this big Tonka toy in the school parking lot, decide to investigate. And I have a problem with that and like to be on the record.
If that's the case then, Rosemary, we shouldn't have anybody around because we have K through 5, and they're going to be excited about the big crane. So we might as well just close K through 8 if we follow that rationale. If I understand you correctly.
I would have no problem with that, Mr. Bolton.
I can accept that because I have a working parent who has no place to put my child because community services are not open for extended daycare. I would like my first grader in school so that you can have during school care and after school care so I can go out and make a living, so that I can pay taxes, so that I can pay other people's salaries.
Child education is all decided by you, but everything that is done inside the school, like the buildings, what we need, room we need added on, portables, is this supposed to normally go through you guys, or is it just the top administration?
I'm going to ask John Holt to answer that because I didn't hear it all.
I guess the question, if I understand correctly, is who does the school board supervise these projects, or past judgment, I guess I'm not sure I understand the question.
Is at least a few involved in all the things that are going on in the school? You know, like we needed to add on the fifth grade, you know, and we needed to add on the fifth grade, you know, make it bigger. Do they take, does the administration ask the school board for maybe to be on that to decide this decision? How much money is involved? Are we doing this school-wise? Anything that goes on to the school?
Up to this point, to answer your question on the renovations in the fifth grade area, no, nobody was notified of that before it was done,
and
as far as I'm on the school board.
The problem we have now in the room.
No, there's no, we don't. Somebody mentioned to me at work this morning if we had a building committee. We don't have a building committee. Maybe we should have a building committee so that we can review these projects as they come along. We have a facilities committee that's been set up to look at the long range facilities that we have and determine any building goals that may be needed. That committee could be looking at the construction projects we have ongoing as well. I don't know if that answers your question or not.
Well, I'd like to see in the future that we have some, I know you're all on subcommittees, that we have at least a subcommittee for the future, that you don't come into with your eyes closed as well as we do.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Is there a timetable that's been set up to do the repairs on the other areas? I'm concerned that, you know, when we talk about snow, sometimes it snows in November, sometimes January. I don't want to be caught with the snow earlier than we anticipated and not have the necessary repairs done.
That work will certainly be done, and I'm satisfied that it's of a sufficiently minor nature that we can get it done without disruption of functioning and well before the snow season.
Well, I think it's time to, oh, sorry. Bill. Say yes or no. Just have to find out the facts. It has to be done in a deliberate, fair, objective way, and that will be done.
Much more interested in meeting all the new kids, meeting his teacher, and
I didn't have to be anywhere, so it didn't matter to me, but I had a very unhappy child on my hands who really wants to go to school tomorrow.
Yeah, I heard that a lot. It was very
disappointing. Legally, isn't the town responsible to hire a bonded contractor? Why are we rehiring a contractor who's not bonded?
I don't know for a fact that we're required to hire a bonded contractor. Is there anybody here, Dee? Is that a requirement of the town? Mr. McGovern, do you know the answer to that?
On the municipal projects of any size of about 10,000, we usually do require bonding. For instance, the portable classroom that this same contractor was responsible for was bonded with a performance bond as well as a labor and materials payment bond.
But it's a custom rather than a statutory requirement, is that correct?
There's no statutory requirement. You know, is there any state funding assistance that the town should get, or has there been any state grants awarded to do some of this work?
On the roofs? No, we borrowed the money to do this work. We did get a number of grants in other areas, that such as asbestos removal. But you recall these jobs were bonded in the sense that we borrowed the money. All right, I think it's time for the board to hold its final discussion, and then if there's a motion, vote on it. Charlie, I'm going to start at your end.
There's a couple issues I'd like to address. One is that I want to see school start, that I think that our education needs to go on. My first concern is safety, and to avoid at all possible costs, rerouting those kids to that portable wing so that they have no contact with the 7th and 8th grade building. I want to address who's in charge. In my opinion, the superintendent is the administrator for our school district. He should be in charge, but the school board is now aware of major deficiencies, and we will be on top of it. I personally will be on top of anything from this point on.
I concur with what Charlie said. It's not, I think giving a simplistic answer about who's in charge, it's just we want you to know that yes, there will be one specific person, the superintendent, who would oversee it, but certainly every single one of us is very concerned about this and will stay on top of it as well. I would support voting for this if there is no doubt that the work will be inspected by an outside engineering firm such as the one that inspected the roofs today.
Somebody asked me this morning why we do what we do on the school board. Had a lot of time to think about that in the last couple of days. We are very concerned. We have spent numerous hours on the phone over the last several days talking about this. This is a situation that is totally unacceptable. What I asked last night at the first special session that we had was to make sure that not only the 7th and 8th grade wing be inspected, but make sure that all the construction that had been done on the roofs when the truss work in the last couple of years be inspected, so that we are absolutely 100% sure that all our kids are working, and teachers, of course, are working in safe environments. I think we did that today. I think to postpone any more education, any more time out of class for our kids, would be a mistake. I think that the five people that you see up here, as well as the administration, are going to work damn hard to make sure that we get this work done as quickly as possible, as safely as possible, and to continue to provide the best education we possibly can for our kids. And I want to echo what Peter has said, that this isn't going to be something that's going to be swept under the rug. We don't have all the facts. We don't have all the answers to the questions that you've asked tonight. And trust me, we have asked those questions, and we've asked a heck of a lot more. We're going to provide you, and we're going to provide ourselves as much information and the answer to those questions as soon as possible.
I think over the next 4 days, things will be very safe. I think that this will be under a microscope like you've never seen, and there will be people watching every moment of every day. I think school needs to begin, and I think it will be safe, and I think there will be no construction taking place or no work taking place during school hours. There will be no one, I've just been sure, in a portable classroom without sprinklers, and that hopefully by Monday this will be behind us. This will be behind us.
Thank you. I've done more than my share of the speaking tonight, but just summing up my view, having spent pretty much the last 48 hours on this, I think we should open the school. I think that's what I've heard the most of from the parents and from many of the students. I think we can do it safely. I think we will do it safely. There will be more than one person in charge. It's not going to be on the shoulders of just one person. This is a team. This is a serious situation. And there are going to be many, many eyes watching this process. And as I said earlier, finding out how this all came to pass. I would entertain a motion from one of the board members.
I move that we authorize the administration to have the removal of the roof of the 7th and 8th grade wing done as soon as possible, that it be done not during class time, that the area be completely roped off as much as possible to keep children away, and to open up school tomorrow for all students.
Seconded. Is there any further discussion? All in favor? I would now entertain a. Now let me back off on that one. I did say earlier that after the vote we would have a discussion of other. Issues related to this general area. I think we've had a lot of those already. I am anxious to get into executive session and would point out that on the Tuesday meeting of the school board, we will be putting on the agenda a number of items that have been eclipsed by this recent situation with our structures. So I really would like to reserve any discussion of those issues, but for another 15 minutes, if people would like to address anything else, I would be willing to do that. Do I see any hands going up? Okay, I guess we have discussed these issues, and before we go into executive session, I want to thank you for coming. For giving us your opinions on the situation, and I thank you. Now, could I have a motion to, do I hear a motion to go into executive session?
I move that we enter executive session for the purpose of discussing personnel issues and litigation. Is there a second?
Okay.